Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from Pastor Luke Cobray.
Well, it's just such an honor and a privilege to be with you tonight. I think that the Holy Spirit has got some great things to say. If you're going to take notes or you want to know the title for reference of the message that we're going to talk about tonight, the title of tonight's message is The Attitude of Gratitude. And I really want to just talk about some things that, I believe that the Lord set on my heart for you to know, every one of us in this place, and how we can live our lives as a blessing and a witness to what God has in store for us. And I remember a couple of weeks ago, I was with some friends and some family members, and we were just kind of discussing, and oftentimes what happens when a bunch of guys get together, we discuss movies. I like to talk about movies. Oftentimes you'll hear in my messages or my talks that there's always like some kind of movie reference. Pastor Dan shot an obscure movie reference to Elf this morning that like nobody caught, but it's all right. And we were talking about movies, and we were talking about movie stars, and we were talking about different things and different movies that we liked. And I remember we were discussing a particular movie star and a particular actor and his family. His whole family is in Hollywood. And we were kind of interested in discussing about it because, you know, the observation that we came up with is that this particular actor and his entire family, the media never really covers it. You never really read very many articles about him or his wife or his children or the whole family that's in the Hollywood business. And there's never really much out there about them. I mean, a movie might come out and then you'll see about the ads and you'll see his name. And if I was to say his name, I'm not going to say his name. But if I was to say his name, you would know exactly who I'm talking about. But we were just interested in the fact that nobody really talks about this actor or his family in the tabloids and social media, on the news channel. Just nobody talks about him. But then on the other hand, we started talking about other movie stars. And it's amazing how many people who have celebrity status are in the social media world, or the news covers them, or they're all over the newspaper covers. And the reason why, the observation that we came up with, is that this actor, his wife and his children, according to Hollywood, according to society, according to you and I and our interests, they live boring lives. There's no drama. They're not doing anything. They live a normal life. They wake up, they go to work, they come home, they go to bed. And then they wake up and they go to work and then they come home and they go to bed every day. And nobody wants to cover that. But then on the other hand, there's celebrities, young celebrities and old celebrities alike, that the media just goes crazy over. Why? Because it seems like every day they're doing something new, something crazy, something stupid. They're throwing their lives away and they have no concept of which way is up or down. If I was to mention a couple of names, you would know exactly who I'm talking to. Why? Because the media has a frenzy about these people. And what we were noticing is, it's amazing, is that, you know, our society, our media, the way we are, it seems to gravitate towards the negative. Nobody wants to hear the story of the person who lives a good and normal and drama-free life. They want to know about the juice, the goodness. Give me the juicy news. I want to know about so-and-so that went to a party and got drunk and crashed his brand new Lamborghini that he bought the day before in a tunnel or whatever it might be. We want to know about that. Human tendency tends to draw us or lead us towards the negative. You know, we experience that in our own lives, not just in the media, not just with celebrities, not just with everything that's going on around the popular culture. We experience that on a deeper level on the inside of our own lives. We see there's this tendency on the inside of us to be drawn towards, to look at, to reflect upon the negative, the hardships, the pains of our lives. A long time ago, I taught a message about pressure and about pain. And if you've ever cut yourself, or if you've ever scratched yourself or gotten a bruise because something hit you or you bumped something, the very first thing you do is you set your gaze upon that injury. Just last night, I was climbing around on my parents' hill trying to find a shortcut to my brother and sister's house. And I stood on a brick that I thought was solid, and the brick fell over and I scratched all the way up my leg on the way rolling down the hill so awkwardly and candidly as everybody watched me in embarrassment. The very first thing I did was look. We have this tendency to be drawn towards the negativity, to the pains, to the hurts, to the hardships. How about this? To the frustrations of our lives. It's just human nature. Maybe in your position or in your life, you've had those times of financial insecurity where it seems like no matter what you do, you can't seem to get your mind off of what's going on with my finances or my job. The time of your life or the period of your life where financial insecurity, or maybe it's something like health or happiness, can't seem to get over it, can't seem to wonder about it. I Googled my symptoms. My wife laughs at me because every time something goes on, I seem like I'm the guy that Googles it and I'm always gonna die the next day, right? She's laughing at me. We like to look at that. We say, well, what's going on? We focus in on our pain, our hardships, the health questions or the happiness. When periods of insecurity come our way, or when relationships start to crumble, or the foundations of everything that we lived on begin to get a little bit wishy-washy, we start focusing on that. We are drawn to the negativity. It's just human nature. As a matter of fact, I remember when I was in university, when I was in marketing class for my business degree, we took this class in marketing, and I remember I saw this very amazing principle, so interesting, about marketing principles. And the principle was this, that if a person has a positive experience, they'll share that positive experience with 2 to 3 other people. Maybe you've experienced that. You've gone out and you've had some good food. You went to that restaurant, you've been hearing about it. Somebody talked about it, and he says, I'm gonna try it out. And it was pretty good. You'll tell 2 or 3 on average people about that restaurant. On the other hand, conversely, interesting principle is that on average, people who have a negative experience will share that experience with 11 to 12 other people. You chuckle because you probably know, right? You've bought that product on Amazon, or you went to that restaurant because Yelp recommended it or whatever it might be, and you saw all those 5 stars, and you're wondering, what the heck was everybody else thinking? So you make it a point in your life to let everybody else know, the world know, to let Yelp know and Google know and Facebook know and social media know, and to call up all your friends and say, do not eat there. I'm just doing you a favor. Just don't want you to waste your time. Don't want you to waste your efforts. You see, there's this natural tendency for us in our nature to focus in on the negativity. Maybe it's because it's more interesting. Maybe it's because it hurts. Maybe because the frustrations of our lives or the hardships or the pains that we go through and that we endure on a day-to-day and a regular basis scream louder than everything else in the world. And so that's just what reflects to us in our nature. But regardless of why or how we do it, we have to look at ourselves and admit, you know what, as humans, we focus on the negative aspects on life very frequently. I don't want to know if a movie's good, right? I want to know if a movie's bad because I don't want to waste my time. And whenever I'm on Amazon or whatever I'm shopping, I'll look at something and it might have 5 stars. I don't want to know the 5-star reviews. That means that the product was good. I want to know why somebody gave it a 1-star. We focus on that negativity. So could we say that just because that's how it is, or maybe that's because that's our nature, because when something happens, I want to focus on the pain of my life, that I'm going through a time of being alone and I just want to focus on that and I want to get out of it, so I'm staring at it. Maybe I'm going in a time of my health going up and down, or questions about my happiness, or I'm just not quite sure where the answers to my life are right now. Maybe I'm in a period or in a time of my finances are not what I thought they should be, and let me just focus in on that right now to get out of the problem, to resolve the problem. And so there I fix my eyes and I fix my gaze upon my issues. Because that's human nature, should we just leave it at that? Is that the way God has called us to live? Is that how it is just because that's how it is? Or is there something more to life that perhaps we're missing out? And I believe that the Bible gives us some very clear answers. Screamingly clear, if that's a word, or if I could say it like that. The Bible shouts at us the clarity of God's direction and His purpose for our lives, and it can be found today. If you've got your Bibles, go with me to the book of 1 Thessalonians in the 5th chapter. Very familiar section of scripture, but look what it says in verse number 16 through verse number 18. To rejoice always, be happy, to pray without ceasing, in everything give thanks. Why? Here it is, the obvious detail that God has for you and I. This is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. This is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Who would have thought I mean, literally, who would have thought that God's desire for us in this place today is to rejoice, to live a life of prayer, and to live a life of gratitude? I would have never imagined that that's what God wanted for me. But you see, the Bible's so clear. This is the will of God. God's will for you is to live a life rejoicing, to live a life in constant communication of prayer with Him, to live a life in the attitude of gratitude continually all throughout the days of your lives. Why? Because God wants you happy. God wants you. God wants me happy. He doesn't want us walking around looking like we're sucking on lemons, sour-faced and fixed on our problems. God says, my will, my desire for you because of Jesus Christ is that you live a life of joy, that you live a life of communication and connection, and that you live a life of gratitude in everything that you do. God wants you happy. The problem is far too many of us in this place aren't. Far too many people who've given themselves the title or the label of Christian or follower of Jesus walk about in their daily lives fixated and focused on the negativity of their lives. Listen, we've all got problems, every one of us. But the beautiful thing is we all have the answer to all of our problems. And God says, listen, church, I don't want you walking around focusing on your problems. One of the things, man, that drives me nuts is when I hear, I'm just a sinner saved by grace. No, you're not. Because you've been saved. You're no longer a sinner. You're no longer dead. You've died to that. You are alive to Jesus. But what we do is we focus on the hardships. We focus on the frustrations. We focus on the negativity that we go through on a daily basis. And God says, that's not my will for you. My will for you is to be happy, to be fulfilled, to be glad, to be in communication, and to be grateful for the life that you're living here because you get one shot at it. And I want it to be full in everything that you do, to enjoy your days here on earth, this vapor time, despite the circumstance we might find ourselves in. And as I was doing some word studies and as I was looking into the Bible, I thought there was a really amazing statement. I'll go ahead and pop those three verses back up on the overhead there for you on the screen. The Bible says to rejoice always and everything give thanks. Those two words, I got to refer to my notes because I don't fluently speak Greek. One of the few times I try not to refer to my notes, but I couldn't remember them. The Greek word for rejoice. Now, just because I want to sound smart to you today, so I looked up the Greek words, okay? So you can be like, man, he really dug deep. The Greek word for rejoice is chareo. Chareo. I know, it's kind of like Vulcan-y, right? Got to get some of that in there. Chareo, all right? That's the Greek word. The Greek word for give thanks is eucharisteo. Eucharisteo. All right, now you're like, okay, Pastor Luke, where are you going with this? Doesn't even matter if you remember that. Totally don't worry about it. Okay, I'm not going to quiz you later on. But you know, the interesting thing about that is of those two words, both of those words, there's what we call a root word in which those words are founded on, are built upon, are surrounded about. And you can see that in the root word there is the word charis or charis. We would get the word charisma. Means grace. Literally defined as grace. So here we see that rejoicing and thanksgiving, those words are founded on the word that literally means grace. Why? Because our rejoicing, our joy, our happiness in life is not based upon what's happening to us at the moment of our lives. The reason we live in attitude of gratitude is not because God has showered us with blessings and favor. We rejoice and we're grateful to God because of God's grace. God has given to us grace, and therefore the root of our rejoicing and the root of our gratitude is the grace of God. The grace of God that empowers us, enables us to get through life, to see God's divine ability, as Pastor Jim defines it, to get the job done on our behalf. Grace, God's unmerited favor for our lives. When we didn't deserve it, God gave it to us. This is the root of why we can live a fulfilled life, not because of circumstance and event, but because we have been given grace. Because of grace, we can have joy despite the circumstance. Because of grace, we can be grateful despite what's going on, despite what's happened to us, despite what card in life we've been dealt, because we've been given God's grace. Our grace is founded, or our joy, our happiness, our fulfillment, and our gratitude is based and founded upon God's grace, not on circumstance. It's easy for us to fix our eyes on what's happening. I'm that way. God has blessed me. When I get a blessing, man, God, thank you so much for your blessing. I'm in a season of my life where, God, you're doing so many things for me, and I can just see it, and I can feel it, and I can experience it, and that's wonderful. But if we base our gratitude and our joy upon seasons, the Bible says that there's a season for everything. There's a time to laugh and a time to cry. There's a time to plant and there's a time to reap. You see, if our joy and our gratitude is based upon a season, then when those seasons of storm and of winter and of cold come our way, seasons when you're going through a financial hardship or your job or with your finances or with your health or your happiness or your frustrations in your life or things just don't seem to be going your way, all of a sudden then your joy and your gratitude seems to go out the window. But when we realize that our joy and our gratitude is founded on the grace of God, it's not based on situational awareness. It's always based on God's ability to get the job done on our behalf when we can't do it. A couple of weeks ago, actually, this last week, I just returned from a trip. I talk about it all the time. I'm like an outdoorsy guy. There's just no escaping it. There's no hiding it. I like the outdoors. So my wife and I, it's one of the things that we like to do together. We enjoy. I know some of you think we're crazy, and that's okay. Different strokes for different folks. That's what I say. We like to go outside. We like to go backpacking. We had this trip planned. I had this trip planned 6 months ago to the T, every day what we were going. We were building all of our stuff, and we had everything ready to go. And sure enough, the day, 2 days before, my wife, Stacy, had some work-related things that came up, and she couldn't go on the trip. But we had already committed to some friends to go with them and invited them along, and so I couldn't bail out because I was taking them with me, my brother-in-law and another friend. And so I wanted just to say, well, Stacy's not going, I don't want to go. And just tell them, you guys just go. But because it was my trip, my itinerary, they didn't know where we were going, and I did, I had to go. And so there we go, and wouldn't you know that on our way up there, there's this great fire. All of California is on fire. Pray for our firefighters. So we see this haze and this terrible smoke, and everything's just looking gross and nasty. So I get on the phone as we're driving up to the mountains there, and I call the permit office and where we're going to pick up the permit for our backpacking trip for the next 4 days. And I ask the ranger on the phone, I say, man, okay, we're headed up. How's it like? And he says, it's really bad. It's really not worth you coming up. Don't come. So we're kind of like, okay, well, there's another place over here, and it's a little bit more south. He gives us some direction. So we go to this other place because we already have everything all planned out, and everybody was already taking their vacation days. So we go to this other place. And there we're backpacking and hiking in this other place. And where I was going, I had it planned. I looked at the books. I looked at the magazines. I'd seen all the pictures. I couldn't wait. It was like the bucket list of places to go. And where we went, there was no water. There was no lakes. There was no streams. There was just sunshine and dirt and bugs and I had just come from the ocean, and I had never gone from 0 degrees to 11,000 feet in one day, and I was experiencing altitude sickness and everything else, and I just had the most sour puss attitude I've ever. I was the worst person to be around. I was a drama queen, if I could just say it like that. Nobody wanted to be around me. We got to camp, and I'm like, this place stinks. This is ugly. My wife isn't here. And instead of sharing my tent with my beautiful bride, I got to share it with a stinky dude. Why am I doing this? Why do I like this? This is dumb. I was mad. I was upset. I was bitter. What a waste of a trip. What a waste of my time. And as I was walking, I just started praying because the reason I go out to these places that I feel like I'm just connected to God and His creation. It's just this connection I have. So I was out there. I couldn't help but to pray and to seek after God. And God kind of spoke to my heart. The Holy Spirit spoke to my heart. You have a really bad attitude. So I started to reflect on that. And I started to think to myself, you know, I'm really blessed. I'm really blessed that I get to take vacation. There's a lot of people out there that work two or three jobs. They don't get to do anything. They don't get to take any time off. They don't even have time to rest. I'm really blessed. I'm really blessed that despite the weather, despite the fires and the mountains, that I was still able to come to see God's creation, to see a place that people, very few people on earth in their lives will ever see because they don't go there. I'm blessed. And I begin to look at things through the eyes of blessing, through the eyes of thankfulness and gratitude. Lord, thank you for your creation. Thank you for this view of mountains that I could see for miles. Thank you for these trees that are thousands of years old that have been here since before Jesus Christ walked on the earth. These trees were saplings. Thank you that I get to experience this. And it was like instantly a flip got switched. My pace and walking began to pick up. My backpack didn't seem so heavy. The food tasted better. The air smelled better. The stars were brighter. Everything seemed so much better. Why? Because my gratitude determined my attitude. Church, today, if there's anything that you get, your gratitude defines your attitude. Your gratitude defines your attitude. I know that's a real churchy, cliche, rhymy statement. But you see, when you're grateful, your attitude, your outlook in life is totally different. Have you ever met a really ticked off, grateful person? Oh my gosh, I'm just so mad right now. And you're red in the face and glaring. Why? Because I'm grateful. No, you'll never meet somebody who's totally upset, totally mad, totally wasted in life because they're grateful. Why? Because your gratitude defines your attitude. And when we live a life based on the grace of God, our gratitude defines our attitude. God didn't call us as His church, as His followers. He didn't give us Jesus that we could have problems and know that Jesus is the answer but not do anything about it. He gave us Jesus as the answer to our problems so that we could change and that we wouldn't have them anymore, so that we could live happy and thankful and in communication with Him. God's desire for us, church, you and me, is to not be a church that sucks on lemons, but to be a church that's full of joy, full of happiness, full of communication and connection with God and communion, and grateful for the gifts that God has given to us through Jesus Christ. And when we live a grateful life, our gratitude defines our attitude. In everything that we do, gratitude defines your attitude. If you've got your Bibles, go with me to the book of Luke in the 17th chapter. Luke chapter 17, there's a really amazing story. I mean, it's just crazy, this story. And I think it's a great representation of what God has to say for His church. Luke chapter 17, let me take my little marker and go there. Luke chapter 17. My marker wasn't there. Oh. There's a story here of 10 lepers. 10 lepers that cry out to Jesus. And look at verse number 11. It starts and says, now it happened. Verse number 11 of 17 chapter. Now as it happened as he went to Jerusalem, that he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. And there as he entered a certain village, there met him 10 lepers who stood afar off because they couldn't come near to him. That was the law. That was the rules. They couldn't come near to civilization. So they cried from a far distance. And they lifted up their voices and they said, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. So clearly they knew who he was. They knew what he was capable of. And yet they cry out to him. So when he saw them, he said to them, go and show yourselves to the priests. And so it was as they went, they were cleansed. And one of them, when he saw that he was healed, returned and with a loud voice glorified God. And he fell down on his face at his feet, giving him thanks. And the Bible adds this little jolt, this little sub note right here. And he was a Samaritan. See, to the people here, to the understanding of the Jewish culture, Samaritan, they were half-breeds. They weren't Gentile. They weren't Jewish. They were outcasts. They were mixed, despised by the people. When Jesus used the example of who is my neighbor, the story of the good Samaritan, it was an example saying that even the outside person is your neighbor. So here, this little addition, he was a Samaritan who came back. Jesus answered and said, were there not 10 cleansed? Where are the 9? Were there not any found who returned to give glory to God except this foreigner? He said to them, arise, go your way. Your faith has made you well. You see, story here, a lot of people will say or believe or they think that, you know, because the 9 never returned that they were not healed, but the one who did because of his faith was healed. I have my own beliefs on that, and the Bible's not clear on that, but I believe it's inconsistent with Jesus' message and his mission. But here I believe it's a story for the church, for you and I, that the people who should have been most grateful, the people who knew, the ones that were longing for a Messiah, the ones who cried out to Jesus, they knew who he was. They cried, Jesus, Master. They should have been the most grateful because they just witnessed his miracle firsthand, the Son of God, the Messiah upon them. The ones who should have been the most grateful never came back. But the one who was an outsider, an outcast, social reject, the one who nobody would have expected him to return, that's the one who came back and said, thank you. Thank you for what you've done. You see, I believe that this is a message for us in our day and age because God has blessed us in this church, in this country, in this nation that we can call the American church, that we are more blessed than anybody else on earth. You think you've got it bad, and maybe you do. But did you know that most people around the world live on less than a dollar a day and a bowl of rice to eat? Yet we don't get to eat the food we want. We have hardships in our relationships and people don't like me and my work isn't going well. You see, we are so blessed. We just don't recognize it. We don't realize it because we're surrounded. We're isolated. We're in this bubble of blessing in our country, and I don't want to get on my political soapbox. That's not what I'm here for. But the amazing thing is that those who are so blessed oftentimes cry out the loudest with negativity, that we have it the worst, that things are going so bad, that we like to complain and focus on what's wrong rather than what's right. And yet here the message is that the one person that nobody expected to return is the one that came back and was grateful because his gratitude was genuine. Because you see, your gratitude defines your attitude. But if your gratitude's gonna define your attitude, it has to be genuine. God's not looking for people to pontificate thanks to him or to reach out manipulations and gratitude and thanks by saying in our mind and in our hearts, if I thank God for it, he'll give it to me. Oh, I've been guilty of that one. God, thank you for something that I want. Hoping that because I thank God for it, I think in my mind and my thought process that I'm grateful. But you see, gratitude, God's not looking for a gratitude of the mind. God's looking for a gratitude of the life and of the heart. Amen. A wholehearted gratitude. I remember, you know, as a pastor, we spend a lot of time in prayer meetings with prayer with other people. And I remember it was a pre-service prayer with our young adult service. And there was this young man, God bless him, great guy. And he was praying there. He was just kind of going before God and he says, you know, Lord, thank you for today. God, thank you for the blessings that you've given to me, even though I don't know what they are. God, thank you for filling me with your Holy Spirit, even though I feel really empty right now. God, I know that you've got a plan for me, even though I don't know what it is. I just had to stop him. Stop. What are you doing? What do you think you're accomplishing with this prayer? Do you think that there's some formula that God is asking for you, that if I add the words, thank you, everything's good in the eyes of God? Because nowhere in the Bible does it say that God's looking for the lip service of my mouth. God wants the desires and the life and the gratitude of my heart to be based on His grace. As a matter of fact, in the book of Leviticus, when they're setting up the law, God says, and we'll just put it up in Leviticus. He says, when you offer a sacrifice of thanksgiving to the Lord, offer it on your own free will. God says, I don't want something based on law and regulations. I don't want you to say thank you because Paul in the Bible said to say thank you. I want you to say thank you because you're grateful. Because your gratitude defines your attitude. Because when you realize the gift that has been given to us in the grace of God, because our rejoicing and our joy is not based on our circumstance, but upon God's grace, then our gratitude, when it's based on God's grace, goes beyond the life circumstances and the negativity and the frustrations that we feel, the hardships that we endure, when our money goes south, when our health fails us, when our relationships begin to crumble and everything seems like it's falling apart. We can still be grateful to God and have joy because it's based on His grace. But what we do, it's our nature. We base our gratitude on the here and the now. Today's my birthday. Thank you. I remember my 30th birthday. My parents made a big hoopla with it for my sister, and I'm the youngest, and youngest always get like the hand-me-downs and everything else, and you know. And so when Jess and Dan got this big hoopla birthday party, like DJ and dance party, and people they didn't even know were coming, I was like, you're not going to get off the hook. When I turn 30, I'm the last one in the family. We're going to have a shindig. I mean, we're going to go down. And I was like a diva. I mean, my family will test. I'm not a big diva when it comes. Well, maybe I'm a big diva on the other end because birthdays, I'm like, I don't want a birthday. I don't care about birthdays. It's just a day. But on my 30th birthday, I'm like, no, we're going down. We're partying. I want it to be like this. I want it to be like this. And man, I remember the gifts that I got on my 30th birthday party. Oh my goodness. People were just showering me with gifts. I was grateful. Oh, I was so grateful. That was amazing. And then my 31st birthday came around. And I didn't get no gifts. My wife and my family and those who were close gave me a little something here and a little, you know, happy birthday nudge. But you know what? In my heart, I wasn't as grateful because it wasn't as big. We come to God like that. God, you blessed me a long time ago, but I don't have anything now. God, I had life years ago when I found Jesus, but I just don't know what happened right now. God, my health was great 2 years ago, but today it's just not doing so good. And I lose my gratitude and my joy. When God says, your gratitude and your joy, it's not based on the circumstance, on God's favor, and on His blessing in the moment, because that comes and that goes. Your gratitude and your joy is based on the gift that God gave to you, the greatest gift the world has ever seen and the world will ever see, Jesus, and what He did on that cross for you and I. The Bible tells us in the book of 2 Corinthians, Paul says, thanks be to God for His indescribable gift, Jesus. When my gratitude is based on Jesus, when I'm going through hell, when my health fails, my money falls apart because it was all in the stock market and everything's taking a dive, when my relationships around me are crumbling, when things aren't going so well with my family or my friends or at my job, when my gratitude is based on God's indescribable gift and not based on the latest blessing that I've received from God, it doesn't matter what happens to me. It doesn't matter what happens tomorrow or what happened. Why? Because I am grateful that God gave to me the greatest gift the world has ever seen. And God's heart and His desire for His church is this, that we would look to God and we would be so grateful for the gift that God gave us in Jesus Christ that if nothing else ever happened again in our lives, it would be enough. Because Jesus is the answer. to our health, to our finances, to our happiness, to our relationships, to our fulfillment. Whether God restores it or he doesn't, Jesus is enough for me, and my grace and my graciousness and my thanksgiving to God and my joy is built upon him and him alone. Because your gratitude defines your attitude. But no gratitude equals bad attitude. Remember, it was Christmas. And Bjorn, my little boy, he wanted a scooter. Everybody had those Razors, those two-wheeled scooters. Well, he's only 2 years old. We knew he couldn't ride a scooter. So we bought him a three-wheeled scooter. And he was so upset. He was so mad. He was like, that's not what I wanted. That's not what I asked for. That's not what my cousins have. He was ungrateful. And at no point did I have the desire in that time to buy him what he wanted. The problem, I think, with the church today in our day and age is we're walking around without gratitude. We're focused on ourselves, our frustrations, our pains, our hurts, our wants, our desires that haven't been yet fulfilled by God. And we're focused on that. And because of that, what happens is they scream louder than the grace of God. And we lose sight of our gratitude. And when we have no gratitude, we have a bad attitude. And therefore, we don't reflect the glory of God like he so desires for his church. But now all of a sudden, we reflect our own desires. And the words hypocrite come out. And the words fake and false and empty and just another religion come out. But you see, when we live and operate in the attitude of a gratitude, all of a sudden, God's glory is seen for the world. And those around us begin to see what happens when we live a life grateful for the gift that God has given to us through Jesus Christ. Take a moment now with me as we conclude. Now, I know I'm not preaching to anybody in this place because you guys are all grateful. But go with me for a moment to an encounter that you've had with another Christian where they had a bad attitude. Another believer you spoke to was not grateful, but they were speaking about their condition. Well, this and this and this and blah, blah, blah. And they're just vomiting their bad news on you. Because it's not you. Go with me there. Now, in your imagination, think about what that situation would have been like if they would have had an attitude of gratitude. How would that encounter have been different? If instead of vomiting bad news and negativity all over somebody else, they shared the love of God and the glory and the story of what God has done in their lives. How would that have changed that circumstance? With that in mind, think about how then can we change, or how then can we impact, how then can we influence our families, our friends, our workplaces, our schools, for those of you that are still in school, the world around us. How can we influence and impact the world around us if we would choose to commit to focus on the grace of God despite the present circumstances? Because a gracious heart, a grateful heart, can't but help but share what God has done. A friend of mine, I see him over here on the front row. I'm not going to mention his name. An amazing man shared with me one of the most heartbreaking stories I've ever heard. Went out to a friend's house and was so grateful. I mean, if you know this guy, he just talks about everything God has done. And there he is with his friend sharing how God has moved in his life. He's so excited and he's so passionate, he can't hold back. And his friend wakes him up at the early morning of the day. He says, I want you out of my house. Get everything of yours and get out. Because you haven't shut up about this God of yours since you got here. He kicked him out rudely and violently out of his house. Heartbroken. This lifelong friendship. What do I do? You see, when you share the gratitude of your heart with the world, they may not always receive it. But we don't share the gratitude of what God has done for us so somebody else would receive it. We do it because we owe it to God, because of the gift of Jesus, to not shut up about what he's done for us, whether they take it or they don't. We share the love of God. And people around you might be changed, and people around you might reject it, and they might think that you're stupid and that you're crazy and that you're foolish, but all at the same time, we cannot contain it because we don't share our gratitude because of them. We share our gratitude because we owe it to our God who loved us in our sin to give us Jesus, the answer to everything we need. So they may reject you. That's okay. Blessed are those who are persecuted for my name's sake, Jesus says, for theirs is the kingdom of God. Church, let's live today. Commit tonight to not focus on the frustrations of our lives. It's so easy and they scream so loud. To not focus on the pains, that feeling of aloneness because our relationships are crumbling or our finances are failing or our job is going rough or our kids are doing this, to not focus on those because they scream so loud at us, but to focus on the subtlety, the still small voice that speaks within us that says, I died for you and I love you and nothing in this world will separate us because of that love. And you are valuable and you are priceless and you are worth it because the heart of God says that the love of God was manifest that Christ died for us. We owe it to God to live a life of gratitude because gratitude defines your attitude. There are too many Christians walking around this day and age sucking on lemons because they forgot why they should be grateful to God. Let's commit to remember that our rejoicing and our gratitude is founded on the grace of God, and that our gratitude defines our attitude today. Did you guys get something out of the Word of God today?
Amen.
God is good, amen. Love of the Bible tells us that the love of God was manifest, made known for us through the love and through the price of Jesus Christ. See, God loved us so much that he said it and shouted it from the mountaintops of the world by giving for us his son, Jesus, to die on a cross, to explain and to exemplify that even while we were in opposition to him, that the unrelenting, pursuing, unending love of God is always there for us. Maybe you're in this place today and you just walked into this place empty with a void on the inside of you, with just a hole or something missing. Today, I wholly believe that that hole is filled. That emptiness can be filled up. Jesus says, the water I give to you, when you drink of it, you'll no longer thirst anymore. But inside of you will flow a fountain of living water, a fountain of life. You see, because Jesus is so far beyond just what happens when we die, Jesus is all about life here on earth because he says, I have come that you might have it more abundantly today. Maybe you're in this place and you just are missing out on life. Maybe you're in a search or in a pursuit for answers or seeking or wondering or answering or just looking, but yet you haven't yet found it. Today, the answer presents itself because the Bible says that no man comes to the Father unless he's drawn. Today, I believe right now that the Holy Spirit is drawing you in. The Holy Spirit is speaking to you in this place right now. Speaking to you saying, come home. Stop doing life your way. Stop living for yourself because you've tried that. You've tried to fill your life with drugs. You've tried to fill your life with drinks, with money and possessions and titles and friends and relationships. Yet no matter what happens, those all seem to let you down. But the drawing of the Holy Spirit, the drawing of God right now on your heart says, come to me, O child of mine. And I'll fill you. You'll find life. You'll find reason. You'll find answers today in the presence of the Holy Spirit. And I don't want to leave and I don't want to stop now and just go on because I believe that the Holy Spirit's here ministering to you in this place. And so I'd like to ask Elijah if you guys could sing that song again, just kind of smooth and kind of, you know, and let's just take a moment. And I want you just to spend some time with God. Maybe you're in this place and you don't know God. Why don't you take a moment, reflect on your life? Because in a moment, I want to give you the opportunity to know God. because he knows you, every hair on your head, every decision you've made, and every decision you will make. But in spite of all of that, he loves you unrelenting, pursuing, unending. Nothing can separate you from his love, and it's time for us to respond to the call of God, to the love of God. Let's just spend some time in that. Elijah, go for it, my friend.
There's no sin, no shame.
Spirit of God's in this place right now, right on your heart. I don't know who you are. I can't even see half of you, and that's all right. But God sees you. You see, there's nothing in the Bible that tells us that our position in a church, that our title that we give ourselves in our life, is what gives us that connection to God. You see, it's that drawing of the Holy Spirit. The Bible says that no man can confess Jesus as Lord unless the Holy Spirit draws him. And right now, I've believed it with all of my heart in this place. There are those of you right now that you've been living life to yourself, you've been living life for yourself, and you've been living this emptiness and this void of this uncertainty, and yet today, the Holy Spirit is speaking to you right now. The Spirit of God is drawing you. You don't even know why you're here tonight, but yet you're here for a reason, because God has called you. Today, I want to give you the opportunity. We'll sing that song, and if we do, if you need to know God, if this is your time, if you say, man, I feel like there's just something on the inside of me, there's something burning right now, and I feel like I need to listen, I want you to do something bold. I want you to get out of your seat. I want you to get into the aisle, and I want you to come meet me right up here in this altar. And we're going to change destinies. Why? Because it's not about your life. It's not about your religion. It's not about your traditions. It's about you and God. And God right now is speaking to you. And if you know right now, if you can sense the Holy Spirit drawing you, speaking to you, saying, come to me, my child. It's time for you to live life. I want you to respond to God today, because the Spirit of salvation is here. The Holy Spirit is upon you. So as they sing that song today, if you know who you are, you don't know God, you're not sure of your position with Jesus Christ, if that's you in this place today, get out of your seat, get out of your chair, and come meet me right here. Let's change that destiny together right here, right now. Let's sing that. If that's you, you come right now. There's more of you in this place. You're wondering, and that's okay. It's okay to have questions. It's okay to not know everything all at once, because God says, listen, you're not going to know everything, but I do. Come to me. Come to me and find life. Stop living life wondering and groping about in the darkness. Now it's time to find the light of the world, who's calling you, who's speaking to you, is upon you right now. You can feel the draw of the Holy Spirit upon you, and I don't want you to miss this precious and wonderful opportunity. So I'll invite Elijah and the team to sing that one more time, and you know who you are because you can feel it, because the Bible says that the Spirit of God is drawing you, is beckoning you, is calling you, and it's time for you to respond. to let go of what you've thought about yourself and give to God what you know you need to. Well, I just sing that one more time. If that's you, come on, particularly in this time.
No past, no pain can separate me from your love. No height, no depth, no fear, no death can separate me from your love.
You can come all over this place. Come and come on. If that's you, you come. This is your moment. Praise God, you came. So cool that the Spirit of God's speaking to you, drawing you. You felt it. Guess what? Today is the first day of the rest of your lives. You're not going to a funeral. I know many of you up here with broken hearts and pains in your life, and that's okay, but guess what? You're not going to a morgue or to a funeral. You're going to a birthday celebration. The Bible says that he that confesses with his mouth and believes with his heart that Jesus Christ is the Lord, Son of God, and raised from the dead shall be saved. Guess what? We're going to do that today. Today, you're going to get born again, to give your heart over to Jesus Christ, to find life for the rest of your days here on earth and eternity with God in paradise. And in order to do that, I want to do something. I want to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here? His name's Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel is going to do just a couple of things. Listen, I promise, I so promise you, nothing weird goes on. Here's what he's going to do. He's going to take you guys just right over there. You don't get saved because you came up here and cried. Okay, that's great. You get saved because you invite Jesus Christ into your heart to be the Lord and Savior of your life. And he's going to do that with you in just a moment right over there. He's going to give you some free information, because I don't want you to leave this place empty-handed to say, okay, I surrendered my life to Jesus. Now what? We're going to help point you in the right direction of what to do with your life in the name of Jesus. The last thing he's going to do is he's going to invite you to come back sometime after church to meet a friend, to connect with somebody. We'll help you partner up with just a friend here at church to get you connected with somebody, to teach you some things about the Word of God so that you get strong in the ways of God and you don't go back to the life that you're deciding to walk away from right now, but you go forward in everything that God has for you, because I tell you what, the promises of God are true, that you have life and abundant life. And we want to teach you and help you to live your life in those days and in those ways. So if you guys would just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with Pastor Joel. Praise God.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.